My presentation is about fiscal decentralization and health service delivery, the Philippine case. Next, please. It is based on three PIDS discussion papers, which are chapters of my PhD thesis. Next, please. Next, please. For my research questions, first, what has been the experience of the Philippines in health devolution? What lessons and insights can be drawn from this experience, which may have implications for crafting future public policies in the country? Has health devolution improved service delivery in the Philippines? And has fiscal decentralization engendered efficiency in health sector, in health service delivery in the Philippines? Next, please. For the objectives of the study, I can't see my slide there. First, to document the country's experience in health devolution and draw lessons and insights that are critical in assessing the country's decentralization policies and also in informing future policymaking, to propose an analytical framework that examines the effects of fiscal decentralization on health service delivery using DID analysis, and lastly, to analyze the efficiency implications of fiscal decentralization using stochastic frontier analysis. Next, please. The next slide is about the outline of my presentation. I will not go over each of them. Can you go to the next slide, please? Okay. The enactment of the Local Government Code of 1991 changed the way basic government health services are delivered at the local level, from a highly centralized system of health service delivery to a devolved system, and that is to achieve efficiency and effectiveness of health service delivery by reallocating decision-making capability and resources to LGUs. Next slide, please. The next slide is an overview of the health devolution in the Philippines. It should be noted that health devolution meant the massive transfer of personnel, health facilities, and budget that had an overwhelming effect on the health sector. Health devolution in the Philippines is considered as the most dynamic and complex scheme in the entire decentralization process. It is the most ambitious health decentralization initiative ever undertaken in Asia, that is according to a World Bank report in 1994. Next slide, please. Next, please. Sorry, I can't see that. So here, I just defined what primarily health services are in RHUs and BHS, which include health education, immunization against TB, polio, measles, nutrition, treatment of common diseases. Next slide, please. The second one, the next slide is on secondary health services, which include medical services accessible in some RHUs, infirmaries, district hospitals, etc. Tertiary health services, medical and surgical diagnostics, treatment, and health and rehab care provided by medical specialists in a hospital setting. It should be noted that DOH takes on the residual powers and functions, including oversight or general supervision of the health sector, monitoring and evaluation functions, formulation standards and regulation, and provision of technical and other forms of assistance. Next slide, please. Here, I think I should highlight this. that Section 17F of the code states that the national government or the next higher level of local government unit may provide or augment the basic services and facilities assigned to a lower level of local government unit when such services or facilities are not made available, or if made available, are inadequate to meet the requirements of the inhabitants. Next slide. I go to the implications of health devolution, issues and challenges. Before health devolution, DOH recognized that many LGUs might be facing resource constraints. There was a policy dilemma then, whether or not to devolve health services to LGUs. But there's wisdom in doing it, that is the urgency of local action in providing health services without seeking top-level intervention. Next slide. However, the fact remained that many LGUs were not ready for devolution. Fiscal capacity of LGUs and managerial capability of LCEs, local chief executives, were not considered prior to devolution. No sufficient preparation to enable those affected by health devolution to cope with tremendous change it brought, and strategic plan for introduction of health devolution was lacking. Next slide, please. Moreover, there are dangers associated with decentralization. Example, political capture within lower tiers of government, decentralizing corruption, and increasing inequality or disparity among others. I just want to cite some existing literature here, or existing studies. First, spending in health and education improves politicians' chances of winning. Re-election objectives of politicians can be aligned with health sector objectives. Opportunistic political leaders employ some elements of decentralization for their own gain. Jurisdictions of political dynasties are characterized by lower standards of living, lower human development, and higher level of deprivation and inequality. There is evidence from the Philippines of the strong negative correlation between voter reports of receipt of private transfers, that is vote buying and provision of community health services. And lastly, politicization of health is a major concern raised by respondents in a study done by Liwanag in 2019, and politics is inevitable in health. Next slide, please. Next, please. Okay. Here I summarize the issues and challenges brought about health devolution into three broad topics. First is financing for health. We all know that this is a long-standing issue, the mismatch between IRA and cost of devolved functions, the cost of implementing Magna Carta for public health workers was not factored in CODEV estimation, and that put more strain on LGU's limited budget. On health personnel, at the early stage of health devolution, there was resistance from devolved DOH personnel and LGUs, that is to absorb the cost of devolved staff. Also, geographic job displacement due to political differences between local chief executives and health personnel. Also, the issue on Magna Carta, which has perverse impact on the relationship between LG Health Office and the rest of LGU personnel. Next slide, please. Organizational and structure change. There were issues on whether the local health boards and interlocal health zones are functional, as well as the issue on fragmentation of health services. The admin of health facilities was transferred from provinces to different jurisdictions, and that resulted in disintegration of the chain of healthcare delivery system, or separation of admin control between primary healthcare and secondary or tertiary healthcare. Next slide, please. So what are the lessons and insights that we can draw from the health devolution experience in the Philippines? First, I would like to highlight this statement that I got from a DOH report. In retrospect, the present reality in the health sector is brought by several factors affecting the delivery of health services. One of these is the devolution of health services to the LGUs, passing on the big responsibility of healthcare to LGUs was done with noble intentions, but unfortunately with inadequate preparation resulting in inappropriate and ineffective health service implementation. So this highlights the importance of a well-planned and well-designed government policy to minimize, if not avert, unintended consequences. And I have to quote this statement from a World Bank report. Hasty and unplanned decentralization, sometimes purely in response to political pressures, can create new problems. And this insight, I think, is deemed useful in crafting any public policy in the future. Next slide, please. A highly decentralized public delivery system brought about by devolution of health services is regarded as a structural weakness based on Solon and Hirian's study. The implementation of the various health reforms has been challenged by the decentralized environment, according to Romualdez. So one can't help but wonder whether health devolution was the right thing to do. But then Solon and Hirian clarify that it is the way health devolution was implemented that fragmented public health service delivery and financing. This also concerns the design of health devolution. I should highlight this statement from Regni. The most appropriate level of decentralization in the health system is an important unresolved political debate. So it's still unresolved. Next slide, please. Some LGUs are better able to reap the benefits of health devolution. There are success stories or good practices. The interesting questions to ask, why is this so? What are the factors that make health devolution work for these LGUs? Insights and lessons can be drawn from their experience, and thus it would be useful to take a closer look at their experience and find out how good practices can be replicated in other LGUs with modifications to adapt to specific LGU context if necessary. Next slide, please. Now we go to the next study, the effects of health devolution and health service delivery. I employed the DID method to infer causal effect of degree or extent fiscal decentralization on health service delivery. So I have 74 observations times 12 years. The observations are actually LGUs, about 1,491 municipalities, 143 cities, and 81 provinces consolidated at the province level in the period 2001 up to 2013, except for 2005 due to data unavailability. I excluded ARM provinces because ARM follows a different organizational and governance structure as mandated in Republic Act 6734 of 1989, and I also excluded highly urbanized cities and independent component cities. On the other hand, Dinagat Islands was integrated with Surigao del Norte because it was part of the province until December 2006. Next slide, please. To ensure balanced panel data, the study employs two data sets, one with 54 provinces to examine the effect of fiscal decentralization on access to hospital inpatient services that is proxied by hospital bed capacity standardized to per 10,000 population and health facility-based delivery that is proportion of health facility-based deliveries or percentage of births attended in health facilities. The second data set is comprised of 37 provinces to examine the effect of fiscal decentralization on access to hospital inpatient services and access to safe water and sanitation. Next slide, please. The hypothesis of my study is this: greater fiscal decentralization results in better health service delivery. The baseline period that I used is 2001 to 2004, which is 10 years after the passage of the code, the changeover phase, and the start of transition phase of health evolution in 1994. The post-intervention period is after 2004, wherein LGUs are expected to have developed adequate capabilities, but DOH incurred huge spending for health facilities enhancement program and deployment of health personnel to LGUs, both of which are devolved functions. Next slide, please. Next, please. For the purpose of the study, I measured the degree or extent of health devolution by using this ratio of local government health spending to general government health spending, where general government health spending is national government, that is DOH spending, plus LGU health spending. The concept of autonomy is explained in terms of subnational expenditure expressed as a percentage of total expenditure. It is the fiscal impact exercised by local or lower governments as opposed to that exercised by the central government. According to Schneider, it is the most appropriate way to gauge fiscal decentralization because a larger proportion of expenditures, in this case health expenditure, is spent by lower level governments in that fiscal impact has shifted away from the central government. Next slide, please. So the next slide presents the control variables that I used for the study. I don't think I should. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, for the findings of this study, health devolution has negative impact on level of access to hospital inpatient services. This is consistent with the narrative in literature on the effect of health devolution on hospitals. There is lower province-level spending on hospitals due to the mismatch between the cost of devolved hospitals and ERA. Such negative effect has remained over the years, according to a DOH administrative order. There is a neglect of public hospitals and health facilities due to inadequate health budget. Next slide, please. LGUs failed to maintain and upgrade devolved health facilities. Other indicators of fiscal decentralization also have negative effect on the level of access to hospital inpatient services. It is counterintuitive as economic literature on fiscal federalism identifies improved service delivery as one of the potential benefits of fiscal decentralization. So, we go to the next study, please. The efficiency of local government health spending. The findings provide empirical evidences on the efficiency implications of health devolution. Health devolution as measured by the HEDR, the one I presented earlier, has positive effect on the mean of the inefficiency distribution, thus adding unnecessary cost. Such findings are not as expected because one of the theoretical benefits of fiscal decentralization or health devolution is efficiency. However, findings of the study are consistent with the literature. Next slide, please. Issues on mismatch between local government fiscal capacity and devolved functions, fragmentation of health system, existence of two-track delivery system and unclear expenditure assignments inevitably create efficiency. So, what are the policy implications and recommendations that we can draw from these studies? The literature on fiscal federalism offers explanation as to why fiscal decentralization fails or succeeds in delivering the expected gains. According to Guman and Singh, impact of decentralization on public services delivery should be accompanied with sound financial resource base of local governments, full autonomy to local governments in human resource management matters, regular capacity building of local officials, performance-based incentive structures, and participatory governance. Next slide, please. Sound financial resource base relates to LGU's capacity to generate revenues. Provinces have weak taxing power, but they have the immense responsibility of maintaining and operating provincial hospitals. Thus, there is a need to revisit and amend the taxing power of the provinces. Next slide, please. The ERA distribution formula has been criticized by, so many, and these criticisms were cited in the Manasan study in 2007. First, vertical imbalances. Lack of an equalizing feature in the formula, thus widening geographic disparities in human development outcomes and level of economic development. There is a need to address these issues, that is to review and revise the ERA distribution formula, especially in the light of the Supreme Court ruling on ERA. If these issues are not addressed, the implementation of SC ruling on ERA starting 2022 will magnify or highlight even more the disparities in fiscal capacity and in turn human development outcomes. Next slide, please. The SC ruling on ERA is a positive development that ensures LGUs of increased fiscal transfers. However, LGUs must spend the ERA and other revenues judiciously and ensure cost effectiveness of local programs, that is getting more value for money. Especially that it will be a huge challenge for the national government to augment whatever shortfall in government services at the local level due to budget constraints. Next slide, please. Huge amount of government funds will be transferred to LGUs in the form of unconditional block grant starting 2022. Local officials should be convinced to invest more on health. DOH will face the challenge of ensuring that LGU's health spending is supportive of the national objectives for health, that is, better health outcomes, more responsive health system, and more equitable healthcare financing. DOH may want to consider expanding its health leadership and governance program to capacitate more local officials and also leverage the facets of the Universal Healthcare Act. Next slide, please. Under UHCA, the Universal Healthcare Act, integration of local health systems into province citywide health systems through a mechanism of cooperative undertaking among LGUs. This ambition ensures the effective and efficient delivery of health services. The integrated health system shall be linked to at least one apex or end referral hospital. In this regard, there is a need to address the deterioration in the access to hospital inpatient services. Also, the need to address the disparity in access to hospital inpatient services, which worsened in 2013 compared to earlier years. Next slide, please. A proportion of the proceeds from RA 11467, that is newly enacted SIN tax law, can be used to improve hospitals and other health facilities as the law mandates that 20% of the revenues shall be allocated nationwide based on political and district subdivisions for medical assistance and health facilities enhancement program. The annual requirements for these programs shall be determined by DOH. It would be interesting to find out how the various tax reforms benefited the LGUs, particularly in terms of improving health facilities, and also the geographical distribution of HF fund in 2014 onwards, as this has implications for addressing disparity in access to government health facilities. On issues on mismatch between local government health facility, fiscal capacity and devolved functions, fragmentation of health services, existence of two-track delivery system, and so on, these issues should also be addressed to fully reap efficiency gains from health devolution. It is critical to review the code section 17C and 17F, which encourage the existence of two-track delivery system, thus bringing about confusion and weak accountability between levels of government and in turn inefficiencies in health service delivery. And I think with that slide, I'm done. Thank you for listening.